symposium a little bit in advance, which is going to give us more time for discussion, but also maybe extra time to refresh before dinner time. And it's now the turn of Gabriele Marino, University of Turin, who is going to present about transonic imageries, visual rhetoric of the face in contemporary experimental music. Thank you, Gabriele.
Thank you. Thanks for the invitation. It's wonderful to be here for the first time here in Warsaw. Actually, the title of the presentation should have been changed a bit. Now it would be something like philosophical premises to an introductory overview of the relationship between transhumanism and music, but we stick to the original title. So, if we semiotically believe that definitions always come in couples, and that individuation, identity, comes from the installation of another, therefore we must postulate that the idea of enhanced humanity, the idea of humanity plus, is implicated in the very idea of humanity itself, and that they have to be all alike. Actually, the earliest depiction of a man trying to go beyond his own nature is perhaps to be found in Genesis 3, in the passage where the man eventually reveals his human nature, being a sinner. So, as we all know, God warns Eve and Adam, you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die. And as we all know, the serpent says to them, you will not certainly die, for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So, once Eve and Adam have eventually eaten the fruit, and I quote, the Lord God made garments of skin and clothed them, and said, the man has now become like one of us, knowing good and evil. He must not be allowed to reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever. So God seems to allow some kind of enhancement to the man. He provides him with clothes, but still establish an impassable limit, death. It's apparent from the verses that I quoted that immortality, outside of God's will, was literally within man's grasp. And although man was banished from the garden, he never gave up hope in his search for reaching it. So, we can say that in order to define himself, man has always redefined himself by editing, modifying, remixing the very notion of humanity. From the one hand, for example, he has pointed up his natural vocation. We can think of the myth of the noble savage by Rousseau, for example. From the other, he has pointed up his cultural one, his artificial one, namely the possibility to overcome his limits as a natural biological being. We can think of Desessin from Joris Carbismon, Aribu, for example, the champion of artificial. The term transhumanism was coined by English biologist and philosopher Julian Huxley in 1957, in an essay of the very same name, so transhumanism. Huxley actually referred principally to improving the human condition through social and cultural change, but the essay and the name of the phenomenon of this philosophical approach have been adopted as seminal by the transhumanist movement, which emphasized material technology. So, to sum it up by paraphrasing a famous song by Freddie Mercury's band Queen from 1986, it is the transhumanists who want to live forever. In our terms, we can understand transhumanism as a form of life, namely, as Jacques Fontanille has extensively argued, a kind of morphological deformation of the whole generative trajectory of meaning, consistent with a set of values lying in the deep level of signification and resulting in their very embodiment. In other words, those committed into such a philosophical approach of human enhancement do not simply believe that humanity is yet to having finished its own evolutionary journey, but they are supposed to act and live accordingly. From these premises, it is clear how, diversely from post-humanism, which is the other main umbrella term employed to define new philosophical approaches discussing the definition and the redefinition of humanity, transhumanism is anthropocentric, and it considers the human perspective on life and experience as pivotal. The following notes are aimed at exploring whether and to which extent we may talk of a musical transhumanism, by referring both to visual features, the representation of the body in the face, artworks, videos, promotional materials, performances, public appearances, and more interestingly to me, sonic features. The former, so musical transhumanism, would constitute a kind of thematization of transhumanism. They would be the features thanks to which musicians would claim their belonging to such a perspective. In other words, musicians talk about transhumanism through their music. The latter, so transhumanism by means of sonic features, would constitute a transduction in Jacobson's term, namely the translation of transhumanism from the verbal realm of the definition of the human to the sonic realm of the definition of the musical. In other words, musician utter produce transhuman music. We can say that our research question here would be something like, does a new conception of man, enhanced man, amplified man, enable a new conception of music? And in such a case, what would be the sound of transhumanism? And is it something that we may define transmusical or transonic? This is the main idea that I'm trying to briefly introduce here. I got interested in this field of research due to my previous interest in the issue of, identity within popular music, with a particular focus on the case of masked and or anonymous musicians. If we stick to the idea that the body, and especially the face, stand as the indexical marks of human identity, both at an ontogenetic and a phylogenetic level, so both for individuals and as a species, we can speculate that in order to express a different kind of identity, such signs would be at the center of an aesthetic effort aimed at reconstructing them on new basis, which would be a generative, constitutive relationship with technology, a relationship in terms of Grimace and Floch of the constructive, mythic, and utopian kind. So, the face is the metonymy par excellence of a given musician's persona. We can think of all the album covers that maybe Everardo is showing in his presentation. So we can use the face as a kind of self-representation of one musician's identity, and the aim here would be to detect whether and to which extent it is being translated into proper musical matter. In other words, in order to verify the consistency of such a form of life throughout all its manifestations. What I present here is just a very partial and very provisional review of the cases in which, in my opinion, such a consistency between the visual and the sonic aesthetics of transhumanism seems to be positive. So, we can start from two big examples from science fiction. Masamune Shirow's Ghost in the Shell and Ridley Scott's Blade Runner from Philip K. Dick stand as two seminal films in the cyberpunk genre. Their soundtracks, respectively provided by Kenji Kawai and Vangelis, are generally regarded as two masterpieces of electronic music and in particular of the dark ambient, so-called dark ambient genre. They're very influential, they're very addressed by electronic music producers, and they are sampled and reused a lot. So we can go to proper electronic music. This is a classic case study in the field. Kraftwerk, a German band, maybe the most important band from the genre of krautrock or krautpop, used to make mannequins perform live on stage as their substitutes. So they used simulacra. And in 1978, they published a kind of manifesto of their aesthetics, whose title is The Man Machine. Another really interesting case is the one of Genesis P. Orridge, or Genesis Brier P. Orridge. Genesis P. Orridge is a musician that is the godfather of industrial music from the second half of the 70s. He founded a label called Industrial Records and is a seminal figure in the field. At a certain point in his life, he married his fiancée, Jacqueline Mary Brier, later known as Lady Jane, and together they embarked in a, as they called it, pandrogyny project, which means the attempt to unite the two of them as a pandrogyny, or a single entity, through the use of surgical body modification, in order to physically resemble one another. So one did surgical operations in order to look like the other and vice versa. Lady Jane died in 2007 and Genesis acquired her surname. I'm not stressing because I have not in the time, but there is a strict correspondence between the visual aesthetics and the musical aesthetics. This is my point of departure. Another interest, I cannot play music because I don't want technical issue, but you have to take it for granted, or maybe I can make a kind of audiocast later. Okay, this is another interesting case. This band is called Devo. Devo, they are from Akron in Ohio. And the guy in the middle is Boygy Boy, who is a kind of poster boy or totem of the band. And the name of the band comes from the theory they propose to their audiences, which is the idea of a devolution, not an evolution, but a downgrade of human life and experience. For example, a great classic of theirs is a really robotic and strange, robotic and primitive at the same time, version of Rolling Stones' Satisfaction. It's really cubist in a way. Then we have an Italian case, he's Alberto Camerini, he used to perform just like a kind of Harlequin, and in a record of his from 1978, he proposed this concept, actually it is a concept album, he proposed this character called Neurox, who is a cyborg, who is a kind of Frankenstein. And the music is really a patchwork of genres, so there is a kind of transduction from one media and from one substance to the other. The other case is a classic in the genre as well. He is Aphex Twin, Richard D. James, perhaps the most important electronic musician in the field of extra academic music, so in the field of popular music. This is a record called Window Licker. It was a single issued in 1999, widely regarded as his masterwork, and some critics says that is one of the most important electronic tunes in the history of electronic music to cure. And this case is interesting because here he creates a trance product wherein it is not the human being enhanced by the technological, but the opposite. Namely, it's the first time that in techno music, which is generally instrumental, he puts samples of his own voice. So it's a kind of reciprocal operation. Another interesting case in which we see the thematization of transhumanism in the face, which is put on the cover, is Billy Idol's 1993 cyberpunk album. For example, we find a very manifesto song, which is entitled Tomorrow People. And it's a concept about technology, seen both in a dystopian and utopian way, in a certain sense. Then, obviously, we have Daft Punk. I just want to say here that Daft Punk are important because they are part of a tradition called by some critics, and among them Adam Harper, this tradition called vocal science, namely the editing, the scientific editing of the vocal parts of the tune, has to convey very different discourses. For example, a way it was employed and it is employed to convey the non-binary nature of the singer or the enunciative stance from a gender point of view. Namely, the voice is so altered in pitch that you cannot understand, you cannot choose between a male or female. And a lot of musicians from house music from the 80s up to James Blake, who is a pop star today, employ vocal science and vocal editing in such a way. Obviously, Daft Punk used vocoder. Today, other musicians use autotune, which is the digital rendition of vocoder. In 1993, Mark Derry, social and cultural critic, American social cultural critic Mark Derry, coined the term Afrofuturism as to refer to a form of retrofuturism, namely a way of thinking of the future as it has been imagined in the past. This is something that Massimo has been digging a lot in some of his papers. The idea is that you feel a nostalgia for the future that you could never be allowed to experience because it's set in the past, that kind of idea of future. Sarah is a pivotal figure in this cultural and aesthetical trend, and very complex figure. He proposed himself as someone coming from the outer space, and so he used to wear costumes and helmets and crowns, and he was all the time disguised, actually. This is a epic moment from the point of view of the history of electronic music, because this is the main anthology from this techno producer from Detroit called Juan Atkins, and it's the classics of his first part of the career, and it's the official birth of techno music as we mean it today. So there is all the influence of Alvin Toffler as a futurologist, and there is this imagery of technology being really intrusive, but in a positive way in human life. Then there is another case from techno music. This is a fictional band called Drexia, but actually it was the offspring of one single person called James Stinson. And there is a whole mythology and all the visual imagery connected to this music, which would be something produced by and for a people from the darkest spots of the submarinian territories or something like that, but they are also aliens, so there is a complex mythology behind that. This is a record from 2019. She's called FKA Twigs. She started producing R&B music and then really took a swerve according to the trend of transhumanism, as the cover picture makes a bit explicit. And then we have another classic case, which is the one with Björk. This album is particularly interesting from a semiotic point of view because it's the embodiment of what we may conceive as transhuman music or trans music in general, because it was partially realized also thanks to the user's interaction with the music via a series of apps that she released just before the release of the official album. And here technology is to be meant in a particular way, because it's technology, yes, but coming from nature, because it's the biological technology of nature that affects the imagery and also the sounds of the album. But we have to say that it's here is a classic example of a cosmetic or aesthetic backing of the transhuman philosophical approach, because actually music is avant pop, but it's not so radical as the cases that we've seen before. This is another interesting case of imagery and also music. In this case, he's called Arca. He's a very young producer from Venezuela, and he's also a producer for Björk. I think that the cover albums of Mutant and Arca are really emblematic for the issue that we are discussing today. This is One of Tricks Point Never, whose real name is Daniel Lopatin, who attributed the title Replica, thanks to the idea of replica in culture as a way we deal with the decline of knowledge. This is a quote from an interview with Polisa. So the decline of human knowledge, the decline of human knowledge going to waste because we are not immortal. This is the kind of imagery and of ideologies backing. Another interesting case from the visual point of view and from the ideological point of view is Proto, which is the follow-up to an album called Platform, really influenced by the theories of platform capitalism and and stuff like that. And this album was created in collaboration with an artificial intelligence program programmed by the musician herself and translated into a kind of personal computer game, so maybe we can deal with that. It features, I quote from an interview, live vocal processing and timeless folk singing with an emphasis on alien song craft. And the album features live training sessions during which vocalists, recruited by Olli Erdon, would teach to the artificial intelligence, which is called Spawn, like the character from the comics, how to interpret sounds. So it's really thematizing and employing the idea of a transhumanist technology. How much time I have left?
Well, so far we have been talking for 20 minutes.
12 minutes?
20 minutes.
20 minutes, okay. So I have 5 minutes or something like that.
Yeah, more or less.
Okay.
Yeah.
I conclude this dolly, like you can see, this review, with an interesting Italian case. They are called DTED. They are a collective of musicians, and they are really into embracing and exploiting also the imagery of transhumanism, because this album called Hyper Beats is explicitly inspired by Timothy Morton's strange science fiction essay, mm-hmm. Hyper Objects, and they are systematically employing this kind of visual imagery. So I try to propose some concluding, maybe, remarks. Okay, I can do that. So, in his futurological book Infinite Music, published in 2011, English musicologist Adam Harper speculates about the possible developments of human musical creativity. He does not explicitly address transhumanism, but still he argues, humanity doesn't equate to a set of given biological, evolutionary, or social constraints, but is constantly adapting and developing from the old, familiar, and limited humanity to new forms of humanity, using tools and technology and increasing its capacity for imagination and information as it does so. Music goes along with that as a part of this process. So, at the end of this book, Harper proposes the categories of alien styles and alien genres as to refer to, respectively, new kinds of music, very different to any earthly style, any music that we can find on Earth, and new forms of music making, entirely new ways of practicing music, so styles and genres. Harper is not systematic in his explanation, but gives us clues, providing a few examples. We can see some of them. So, if we want to trace a kind of genealogy of a trans music, transhuman music, by means of sounds, this genealogy would encompass self-invented instruments and scales. This is Henry Patch, who used to invent his own instruments. Karlheinz Stockhausen, the cover of the Beatles' Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band from 1967. So, radical manipulation of sound in all its dimensions, timbre, rhythm, melody, etc. Graphic notation and heterodox notations. This is part of the score from Cornelius Cardew's treatise. And we may add to this partial and provisional list also the discovery of new sounds as musical sounds, thanks to the invention of the instruments that would create, recreate, and manipulate them. The most important example probably is Luigi Russo and his noise intoners, and the implementation of sounds and sound structures that are impossible to be performed by a human agent. For example, this is a very interesting apex in the history of electronic music, because this is a tune by Moby called 1000, because it is a piece that goes faster and faster up to the humanly playable speed of 1000 beats per minute, BPMs. So this is literally an enhanced, amplified music. So we can widen our perspective on the relationship between transhumanism and music, going beyond transhumanist imageries in music, towards what we may call transhumanist music, trans music, or transonic music. Music going beyond overcoming music. Transonic music would include, for example, infra and ultrasonics, which are sounds that we cannot actually hear. Music enhanced by means of synesthesia, from multimedia to other kind of music that we cannot even imagine, perhaps. And even music not dealing with sound at all. For example, in early 70s, New York saxophonist and composer John Zorn had already imagined and practiced music without sounds in a project called Theater of Musical Optics. Adam Harper, Sally and Stiles and Jans are music to a transhuman being yet to come, actually. Maybe their ambition would be exactly to construct by anticipation this kind of being. So it's music anticipating humanity in a certain sense. According to Jacques Attali, in his futurologic essay from 1977, Noise, music, in the respect of being an enhancement of the human already, has always had this kind of anticipatory role. So a human being capable to listen to music as normal music of this kind is no more a simple human being. By paraphrasing a famous essay by Thomas Nagel, the challenge of contemporary transhumanistic music would be answering to this one question: what it is like to be a transhuman listener. I'm about to conclude. We do not have an answer to this question, but we can almost visualize it. In 2007, the Cypriot-born Australian performance artist Stelarc began a series of three surgical procedures to insert a soft prosthetic ear into his left forearm. Far from the act of replacement, this no longer replicates human hearing as such. As conceived, the extra ear purpose is not merely to receive new acoustic signals, but rather to transmit them. So a miniature microphone was initially implanted within the ear and functioned for more or less 2 weeks, transmitting sound signals via Bluetooth to an external device. So Stelarc's permanent bodily performance stands as the embodiment of what Andy Clark's has defined: the human being as a natural born cyborg, capable to fully incorporate tools and supporting cultural practices into our existence. Musicians visually embracing a transhumanist aesthetic tend to translate it into a musical fashion, is what I tried to demonstrate here. But there is a whole world of musicians with no transhumanist appearance, namely with no transhumanist aesthetic as the index signaling that they may be developing a transhumanist or transonic music, who actually do so. In other words, the category of transhuman articulated as transhumanist or transonic music could be an interesting interpretative category for rethinking the whole history of music, starting from modernism. And I'm really concluding. In an essay published in 1917 on the avant-garde magazine 3091, created by Francis Picabia, Edgar Varèse, the champion of musical modernism, argued, "Our musical alphabet is poor and illogical. Music, which should pulsate with life, needs new means of expression, and science alone can infuse it with youthful vigor. I dream of instruments obedient to my thought and which, with their contribution of a new whole world of unexpected sound, will lend themselves to the exigencies of my inner rhythm." In the very same year, he founded an association to promote the new music, as it was called at the time, an association called the International Composers Guild, and its manifesto opened with this motto, later recovered by Frank Zappa: "The present day composers refuse to die." Thank you.